Darkcast Network. Indie pods with a dark side.
Devil is on his way, motherfucker, the devil gonna make you pay. Fall to your knees, devil is on his way. Fall to your knees, devil gonna make you pay. Fall to your knees, devil is on his way.
Mountain Murders is an Appalachian true crime podcast. Some content may not be suitable for all listeners. Listener discretion is advised.
We say fuck a lot.
Hey, y'all. Welcome back to Mountain Murders. I'm Heather.
And I'm Dylan.
Hey, Dylan. How are you?
I'm doing great.
You're great.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I'm a little upset because we missed our midweek last week.
I blame Mother Nature.
We are late getting this episode out, but it is beyond our control.
Definitely beyond our control.
We had a pretty serious storm that rolled in the other day, knocked out our power, took out the internet, and when they were finally able to get the internet fixed, our modem was fried. Then we had to wait for a technician to come out, bring a new modem.
Just go ahead and say blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, all that boring stuff.
Yes, but here we are. We are back. So Heather was like, you know what? We had half a midweek done. Forget that. That's old news.
Results, not excuses, right? So here we are bringing the results. We have a case for you today. Are you ready, Dylan?
Oh my God, we got a case for them?
Before we get started with our case, you have a show sponsor.
Yes, today's episode is being sponsored by Amber, who so generously contributed to our Patreon. Thank you very much, Amber. And all the dumb stuff I say from henceforth will be her fault.
You also have to thank Scott.
And Scott. I thought I'd already gotten Scott last week.
Let's just go ahead and look, thank Scott again.
I'm gonna thank you, Scott. And if I've thanked you twice, then that's fine.
Okay.
But we got to make sure we thank our patrons.
We sure do, because they are helping to keep the lights on here at Mountain Murder Studio. They are a very important part of the secret sauce, Dylan.
It's true. Thank you, Amber. Thank you, Scott. Quite possibly. All right. So we're just going to dive into it.
We're going to dive into it. No dilly-dallying today, Dylan, even though I know you are the Dylan-y, dallianest person I've ever met.
I've been on fire today. Look, you got to give credit where credit's due. I have a lot of projects building up around the house. I've been working a lot, which is a good thing. Putting up a little bit of fence. And, today I was just like, you know what? Those cardboard boxes in the corner, something's going to happen to those. They're going to get processed. Yeah.
I'm glad you finally decided to step up and accept responsibility for your household. It's great.
Thank you. I'm waiting for the positive reinforcement, but.
Now, the story I'm about to tell you is truly a parent's worst nightmare, Dylan.
Oh, my gosh.
Now, I know last week we brought you the Todd Ice case. Very disturbing story. This week's case is equally as disturbing, but I think it's going to bring up some important questions and maybe more of that debate and discussion that we discussed last week.
I got to say, the Todd Ice story had me thinking about it like days later. It was such a strange story.
Well, I think this one is going to also make you think a little bit. And question whether laws that are on the books are for privacy are actually a good thing or causing more damage to the community.
So this is going to be a case that makes you go, mm.
Yeah, so okay. Let's get into it. In August of 2021, USA Today published an article entitled Sleepovers, Safe or Dangerous? Child Experts Share Rewards, Risks. Now, the article was prompted after a debate raged on the social media app TikTok, in which some parents stated they would never allow sleepovers for their children. Dylan, what do you think about sleepovers?
Well, I mean, I've never had an issue with them at my house because I guess I know my house and I know they're being monitored properly and nothing crazy is going on. But every time my kids went to sleep over at someone new's house, you know, you don't know their parents, you're not real familiar with the family, it can make you quite nervous.
Some parents weighed in supporting the decision, while others pointed out, you can't control everything. And quote, just because something could happen doesn't mean it will happen. But child development experts say sleepovers can be an important developmental step for children, helping them navigate independence, practice flexibility, and gain exposure to different family cultures, if you will.
Now, were you one of those kids that would be all jazzed about the sleepover and then like 2 hours into it, you're calling wanting to come home?
Yeah.
And that was you?
Yeah.
You were over it.
Okay. I was not always that child, but there were certain places where I might try to spend the night, and after a few hours, I'd be ready to leave.
Just bored?
Yeah. Okay. Like, for example, I had a set of cousins, like kind of distant, you know, like second cousins or something, but they were in and around my age, and they lived close by as well. So I would go spend the night at their house, or would try to spend the night at their house. But there were like two older cousins, right?
Yeah.
And then the one that was like closer to my age, but they would just pick on me.
Oh, hold on.
They tried to scare me all the time. And so, you know, just before bedtime, they'd be like, oh, do you see that person staring in the window? You know, just shit like that. And they had me convinced that their basement was like a terrifying place. I mean, you know, just fucking with me because I was the little kid and I guess they just wanted to pick on me.
So they're just carrying on.
So I always would call my mom to come get me.
You're like, yeah, I'm not doing this.
Yeah. Yes. I didn't come up here to be tortured all night.
Yeah.
Know?
Yeah,
I don't want to hear discussions about the red glowing eyes in the window. Woo.
Oh, it's a damn Mothman. Harbinger of doom.
Yeah. So that was one of the reasons why I was a call home kind of kid.
Okay.
What about you?
There wasn't a whole lot of opportunities for sleepovers that I recall. But I'm a trooper. You know?
Yeah, no, I had a friend's. I mean, like friends' houses, I was always fine. It yeah. was really like I would just want to go home from. I think about this. I think it was just my cousin's house in particular.
Now, you know, when you go stay with your bestie for like a few days, like a long weekend or yeah. something, and you get there and you're both like, this is going to be the greatest time of our life. And then comes like Sunday evening, you hate each other and you're fighting and arguing. And then, you know, it's time for a few days apart.
Yes.
Yeah.
You can't decide what to play.
Yeah. You're like, man, whatever, dude.
Why do you always get to be the teacher? Why do I have to be the student?
I don't want to play duck hunt anymore.
Exactly. Right.
All right.
Okay. So sleepovers may test the limits of some parents' discomfort, but they are useful ways for children to exercise some separation from their caregivers. Sleepovers, for me, are some of my most fond childhood memories, even if I did call home when I stayed at my cousin's house. I mean, there's a fine line between raising kids who understand things like good touch, bad touch, when to heed their, you know, spidey senses that something isn't safe, how to call home for help, and when to extricate themselves from a bad situation. And raising kids who are afraid to go out into the world. I mean, that's another part of it.
Well, I see the benefits of sleepovers, and I think it's certainly some good social skills can be built, and, you know, just trying to work through problems yourself if you're having some minor issue or something. And when we were younger, it was quite a bit harder to stay in communication with your child. Nowadays, everybody has a phone and text apps and all this, and you're basically getting a play-by-play from whoever when they're at someone's house. But, you know, I would always be worried about, can my kids communicate with me if they all of a sudden are uncomfortable and don't, you know, can go around the adults in the house and contact me, which we were lucky. There were cell phones available.
Oh, yeah. So I remember having a bad experience when I was in the sixth grade, I think it was. I went to a girl's birthday party, sleepover, was not very familiar with her family. We were not close friends. As a matter of fact, it was almost kind of random that she invited me. But I was like, okay, cool. I go to this party. Her parents leave. Now, we're like 11, 12 years old. Definitely, I was not an age where my parents were leaving me home alone.
So they just take off?
Her parents left. Like, went out partying, I guess. Left us there all freaking night by ourselves. There was no phone in the house.
No, this is not okay.
There was like the pizza they had ordered and some drinks, and that was it. So, of course, when the pizza ran out, there's like no food, no snacks, nothing to drink, tap water.
Oh my God.
Completely unsupervised. She had a little brother that was much younger than us running around, and we were supposed to be watching him. And I remember thinking, like, this kid's a maniac. Like, even in my 12-year-old brain, I was like, what is wrong with this kid? Like, he was wild as hell.
So they take off with a house full of other people's kids.
Yeah. There were probably 6 or 7 little girls.
Yeah, that's not okay.
And I remember the house was really dirty. And that was another thing that I would always be like, ooh. Like, I don't know. My mom was like a clean freak, and I never grew up in like a dirty home. And I've always just been really weird about, you know, gross things. And I remember thinking, like, I don't want to sleep on the floor.
Oh, no.
You know, like, sleep over, and we're piling our sleeping bags. And I just remember there was, like, dog food spilled out on the floor. And, like, you could tell this house had probably not been vacuumed. Maybe air. I mean, it was just, it was a pretty gross, it was pretty dirty. And I was just very, very uncomfortable. Didn't want to be there. Couldn't call home. And then the girl started smoking cigarettes.
Oh, God.
Which totally weirded me out because I was a very square kid and was not exposed to this type of thing. And I knew I would get into so much trouble. I didn't want to smoke. I've never been a smoker. And, so, of course, they're trying to peer pressure me. And I'm like, say, I don't want to. You can't make me.
Degrassi Junior High peer pressure?
Oh, yeah, maybe.
They're like, come on. Come on. What are you, chicken?
Yeah.
Buck, buck, buck. Okay.
And I was just like, I don't want lung cancer, but okay, cool, guys. Enjoy your COPD.
Well, this is the thing.
When you're 16.
Now, in my opinion, you have to let your kids try these things to a degree, within reason. But you also have, I'm that parent, you know, some parents will just pull up and kick their damn kid out the car door and they're gone. I have to come to the door. I prefer to step inside, even just in the living room. I want to know who all, what all adults are there. There's their, you know, weird cousin or brother, you know, grown-ass man staying there. I need to know these things or I'm not going to be able to, I'm not going to be able to deal with it. Just like your daughter, my stepdaughter's going on 18 and she went and stayed at a friend's house. I want to call her. I'll text her. I was like, what's your exact address? Where you're at? If I need to plug that shit in Google Maps, bro, I'll be there, you know? So these are the things I need to know as a dad.
Exactly. So, yeah, I think, you know, it's something to think about when you're sending your kids off to a stranger's home, especially in this day and age where anything could happen, you know. Even, I think, good parents who are supervising the kids can sneak around and do shit behind your back. And, I mean, you know, it's scary.
Oh, my God. Nowadays, it's hard to control that. I mean, there really is with all these secret apps and, you know, kids know more about the internet than we do typically.
Yeah, for real. Okay, so let's move along to get to the meat of our story. And again, Dylan, it's pretty disturbing. It does involve a child. If you have issues with crimes relating to children, you might want to skip this episode. If not, let's get into it, Dylan. 12-year-old Jessica Thornsberry was like most girls her age. She was kind of caught between, I guess hence the word tween, right? Being a child and becoming a teenager. And at this age, children start to develop more independence, moving away from their parents emotionally, though they still need a lot of support. I mean, I remember 12. It was such an awkward age for me. You're starting to hit puberty. There's a lot of physical changes. You're not quite a child anymore, but you're not an adult yet or even really a teenager.
And you're staring down 13, right? You're going to officially turn into a teenager, which is very worrisome for some.
Well, yeah, because you don't even know what that means exactly. I mean, you keep hearing like you're going to be a teenager, but you're like, what does that even mean?
It's almost like when you hit 10 and you're not single digits anymore. You know?
Well, I kept thinking teenager, I was going to be like Sandy and Danny from Greece, but they were like 35 playing teenagers.
Can we say that you were watching Grease once? You've watched that like 20 times since I've met you 5 years ago, which is fine.
Anytime Grease is on, I'm going to watch it.
It's fine. But they did, you know, in the 80s especially, they would cast, I guess maybe 70s, 80s, just full-on adults with mortgages, twice divorced, to be high school students.
Yeah.
And we know it's a thing. They've always cast someone who's a little bit older. They typically don't use teenage actors. But in Greece, dude, these cats were like freaking 48.
Right. So I had all these expectations that when I was a teenager, I was going to look like a, you know, middle-aged woman. And then I didn't. So, you know, mixed feelings. Well, Jessica's best friend was a girl named April Gipson, who lived nearby. On multiple occasions, Jessica, along with her sisters Patricia and Stephanie, had been guests in the Gipson home. March 29th of 1995 was a Wednesday, much like any other in the 12-year-old's life. I'm assuming, just having read some of the information, that it's possibly like a spring break type of situation.
Okay, so you got a long holiday from school.
Possibly. April invited Jessica to sleep over. So around 8 p.m., Jessica's mother, Diana Thornsberry, dropped her daughter at the Gipson home on Central Avenue. As soon as Diana arrived back home, she received a phone call from her daughter. Jessica asked permission for Carolyn Gipson to dye her hair. And Carolyn is April's mother.
Would you give that permission?
Depends, I guess.
Depends on...
What are we doing?
Whether or not your child's already dyed their hair before.
Yeah, exactly.
Is it permanent? Is it Kool-Aid? What are we doing?
Right, well, Jessica just wanted to dye her hair blonde, so she wasn't getting too wild and crazy. Again, this is the 90s, so it's not like she's doing the blue hairs or anything like that. And Diana agreed. Now, I don't know if this is something that Jessica has done before, but Diana was like, sure, you can dye your hair. Jessica and April then walked to a neighborhood store to purchase some hair dye. And it sounds like they lived fairly close, just a few blocks away from each other, and that this residential area, it wasn't too far off from a store, a neighborhood where there's a lot of kids.
Very walkable.
Yeah, and it kind of sounds like the kind of neighborhood where if you were a 12-year-old kid, you'd want to live in this neighborhood because you're surrounded by other kids. It's walkable. There's lots to do.
I always want to live in a neighborhood with a whole bunch of kids that you could play with all the time and make like some dear friends.
Yeah, wouldn't that be fun?
It would be fun. Maybe a really nice cul-de-sac in the like middle class cul-de-sac.
I just grew up in the trailer park with some like other fucked up dysfunctional kids.
Yeah, like, look, the police was over there last night around 1 p.m. You can't, or 1 a.m. in the morning. You cannot go over there and play no more.
There's that kid Jimmy who's always tearing the legs off the frogs.
You stay away from that old rusted trailer down there. You're going to get tetanus.
Yeah.
Right.
On their way to the store, the girls met up with some neighborhood boys. When they arrived back at the Central Avenue house, Carolyn dyed Jessica's hair. The three, meaning Carolyn, Jessica, and April, started watching TV in the living room. April's 17-year-old brother Jeremy was upstairs with his girlfriend Rachel Thies in a bedroom. And at some point, the neighborhood boys, who were aged 11 and 13, knock on the door asking for April. April, Jessica, along with a younger Gipson brother, this must have been April's younger brother, and his friend, were all invited to go hang out on the porch with these two boys, and they kind of spent the evening chatting out there, you know, maybe an hour, hour and a half, until about 10 p.m. or so, which seems like a pretty reasonable curfew, I suppose.
Yeah, if there's no school tomorrow.
Right.
10-ish seems fair to me.
So at this time, the boys went home, and everyone returned inside the house to watch television and start getting ready for bed. April and her mother, Carolyn, were watching TV in the living room with Jessica, and it sounds almost like they had some kind of sleeping arrangement set up in the living room. Like they had the, you know, the little floor pallet, or, you know, everybody piles up the blankets on the couch and then the floor.
Well, you got to make a fort.
Yeah, exactly. So April and Caroline, they end up falling asleep in the living room about 11:30 or so. Jessica, who was wide awake, didn't want to disturb her friend or her friend's mom, so she went into the kitchen and started watching television there. So the following morning, Carolyn Gipson got up around 7 a.m. and rushed off to work. She noticed April was still sleeping on the living room floor, but there was no sign of Jessica. Not thinking much of her absence, Mrs. Gipson assumed the floor had been too hard for the young girl and that she had likely gone upstairs to sleep in April's bed, which is a pretty reasonable assumption.
So she's making all these observations kind of on the fly.
Yes.
I'm going to hurry up, get ready, go to work. Well, she's not down here. She must have went upstairs.
Yeah, and I feel like there was always the kid who would go get in the bed. Like if you did have a sleepover planned and everyone is piled up in the living room or in the den.
Right.
There's like always the one kid who does go and get in the bed.
Used to apostropedic.
Exactly. Jessica had been an overnight guest in their house before, so Mrs. Gipson, she didn't really have a reason to worry. April woke up shortly after her mother left for work. She searched the house for Jessica, but her friend was not there. So now, as a kid, can you imagine your buddy staying over, you wake up, your mom's just gone to work, and your friend is nowhere to be found? Would you be like, what the heck?
I would be alarmed, even as an 11, 12-year-old. Would you not be?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, April didn't immediately call an adult. She instead waited around to see if Jessica came back. By 10 a.m., April figured that Jessica had gotten up earlier and walked home. And that is when April called Diana Thornsberry to ask if Jessica was there. Diana had not seen her daughter since the night before when she dropped her at the Gipson house.
Now, can you imagine Diane's reaction when, you know, you dropped your kid off, you didn't get any more, she's going to dye her hair, everything seems to be fine. And now you have the friend, where you dropped her off at, calling, asking you if you've seen her. Now, at this point, I would be very alarmed.
Oh, yeah. That's when your stomach starts knotting up and you're getting that sense of panic just rushing over your body, right? Jessica wasn't at home, and there was no sign that she had been there during the night. Like most parents, Diana had a strong reaction to the news that her daughter was missing from a friend's house. Diana knew Jessica, and it was out of character for her daughter to wander off without telling anyone. She knew Jessica wouldn't walk home on her own without letting someone know she was on her way. Also, Jessica was not in the habit of leaving a friend's house when she was a guest. Like, she would have thought that was rude to just leave.
And not tell anybody what you're
exactly.
doing.
Exactly. Diana called the Louisville police to file a missing persons report and proceeded to look for her daughter in the neighborhood. And they do live in Louisville, Kentucky, by the way.
Louisville.
One of.
I think that's how they say it.
Well, I'm from Waynesville, and I say Louisville.
It's certainly not Louisville.
Are you sure?
I'm certain
is
of it.
Is it Louisville?
It's not Louisville either.
How do you know?
Because the Louisville Slugger.
4 miles away that morning at Iroquois Park, something was happening. Now, Iroquois Park was constructed in 1891 and designed by renowned landscape architect Frederick Law Olmsted, who you may have heard of before, Dylan. He actually designed our local Biltmore Estate gardens.
When you said the name, I knew that was the guy.
Yeah, he's a pretty famous guy, and the local botanical garden in Asheville, it's like a big statue of him.
If
a lot
I'm
of information about him.
Not mistaken, he studied in Europe and brought those techniques to the Americas.
Whee!
Wow, damn, why do I remember that shit?
I don't know, because you paid attention on the tour.
Okay.
It is a cornerstone of the Louisville Park system, located in the south end of town. It looks awesome, Dylan. It features old growth forest. There's an archery range, a golf course, horseback riding trails, stables, many trailheads, tennis, disc golf, outdoor splash pads, and an amphitheater that seats over 2,000 people.
Well, damn, this place sounds incredible.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm like, damn, I wish we had a badass park like this.
I would just always be, people be like, where you at? I'd be like, the park, bro.
So it's 8:30 a.m. and four Metropolitan Sewer District workers were at the park checking on a recent drainage project. Next to a park road, there was straw netting placed to help grass germinate over some new dirt. Between the golf clubhouse and the riding stables, the employees noticed that some of the netting seemed to be all knotted up. While untangling the netting, they discover the body of a young girl. She's lying face down wearing a green sweatshirt and black jeans. Horrified, the workers flag down Sergeant Carl Yates with the Louisville Police Department. I guess this officer just happened to be in the vicinity of the park.
Patrolling, basically.
Yeah. So, you know, it just happens that they find him and they're able to tell him what they found. Now, this is the same outfit that Diana Thornsberry would report to law enforcement when she made the missing persons report a few hours later regarding her daughter, Jessica. When Diana called the police, officers arrived at her house on Powell Avenue to take the report. And during this meeting, officers requested a photograph of the missing girl to aid in their search efforts. Less than 2 hours later, Louisville police officers would return to Diana's house to deliver a shocking blow. Jessica had been found murdered at Iroquois Park earlier that morning by those MDS workers. Confronted with the catastrophic news, Stephanie and Patricia fell to their knees weeping. It was reported that Stephanie ran from the house screaming when she finds out what's happened to her sister.
Well, you know, this is the case a lot of times in these missing person reports. Eventually, usually, unfortunately, that's why we talk about them. They find remains or the body somewhere. But this is all happening very fast for Diane.
Very fast.
And that's got to be almost even worse because you don't even get to cling to, you know, a little bit of hope or something for a little bit. I don't know which would be worse. It would be terrible either way.
Diana was in disbelief. I mean, how could this happen? She had so many questions. Jessica had been safe, she thought, at her friend's house. How had this 12-year-old ended up 4 miles away at this park?
Yeah. When I dropped you off at a friend's house, that's where you should be at.
From the ligature marks around her neck, Sergeant Yates knew he was dealing with a homicide. Quickly, Louisville police began interviewing those who were last known to see Jessica, including the young neighbor boys who had been at the Gipson home the previous evening. Investigators soon realized that the boys had nothing to do with Jessica's murder. April and her mother Carolyn were interviewed as well. Both were emotional, as you can imagine, and completely baffled as to what had happened after they had gone to sleep. This is so scary for a number of reasons, Dylan. As a parent, it would be horrifying to get a phone call that your child is missing from their friend's home.
Yeah.
But as a parent, that you've been entrusted to care for this child, your daughter's friend, your child's friend, they're in your home, you are tasked with protecting them, you go to bed, everything seems normal, you wake up and find out this child's missing from your house. How much guilt and responsibility would you feel?
Well, I'm not. It would be. It's certainly different. It's someone else's child, and it would be bad if it was your own child, obviously. But I don't know. I'd be beside myself because I would be. For one, I'd want to know what the hell happened, and I would feel like I'd failed as a parent, you know, because you're supposed to be the steward and protect everyone that comes into your house.
April's older brother, Jeremy, who had been in the house with his girlfriend, told police that he had seen Jessica on the telephone around 11:30 p.m., and it was the last time he claimed to have seen her. However, a piece began to fall into place when law enforcement interviewed the 25-year-old neighbor, Mike Moberly, who lived next door to the Gipson house. The two homes shared a common driveway. Moberly told law enforcement that he'd heard noises outside the bedroom window around 3:30 a.m. He thought he had heard someone walking between the two houses. Alarmed, he looked out the window and saw a blue Chrysler LeBaron in the driveway. Moberly knew the car belonged to Jeremy Gipson's girlfriend, Rachel. 17-year-old Jeremy was kind of leaned or propped up against the car smoking a cigarette. Thinking nothing of it, Moberly went back to bed. Though a few minutes later, he couldn't sleep, so he got up again and once more glanced out the window. This time, the LeBaron had been moved. The car was now backed into the driveway with the trunk facing the Gipson home. Okay, he thought to himself, like,
what are they doing?
What's happening?
Why are you out here at 3 a.m. moving cars around?
But he just went back to bed. Like most people probably would do if they saw this, right? You're not going to invest too much time into trying to figure out what your neighbor's up to. When police asked if Moberly thought that Jeremy might have something to do with Jessica's disappearance, the man dismissed the idea. He told detectives that Jeremy was an okay kid, and as a matter of fact, they had played basketball earlier on Wednesday afternoon in the driveway together. He said, quote, he's a good guy. He couldn't be involved. Yet Moberly added a detail which intrigued investigators. He said, quote, I heard he had some problems with police a few years ago, but I'm not sure what that was about.
Now, that's certainly going to pique an investigator's interest. And they're going to look into that and find out exactly, A, if there are any substance to that statement and exactly what happened.
Curious what kinds of problems a 17-year-old might have with law enforcement. They immediately began digging around for juvenile records on Jeremy Gipson. And what they learned left them speechless.
Yeah, there's a lot to talk about in this case. I'll tell you, I can't wait to get into it.
Jeremy Gipson was a juvenile sex offender.
And nobody knew, right?
As we know, sex offenders are responsible for committing debatably the most heinous crimes on the planet. I mean, if you listen to Mountain Murders, then you know how Heather and Dylan feel about these sickos.
I don't even have to tell our listeners what I think about this.
Yeah. So, of course, we think that they are the worst.
They should die. I just had to say it. I'm sorry.
The chance they will reoffend is high. And the sex offender registry allows communities to be on high alert and know who is living next door. Yet there is a group of sexual predators who are protected, and that is juvenile offenders. Due to their age, juveniles are protected by the law. Laws regarding juvenile offenders are much more lenient than those governing adults. Offenses, convictions, and all records related to minors are kept secret from the public. Communities have no idea how many juvenile sex offenders are roaming their streets. In 2005, the maximum sentence a juvenile offender could receive in Kentucky was 3 years in a juvenile detention facility. 3 years for a crime that can often carry up to life sentences for adults.
3 years. Now, what do you feel about that? And I understand why juvenile records are private and sensitive, because they are, you know, a lot of times, people do dumb shit when they're younger, you know what I mean? And you shouldn't have that drag you down the rest of your life. But I think there are certain categories. I don't care if you're 12 or if you're 50. I think certain crimes are just, that means something's wrong with you. It doesn't matter your age.
I don't disagree with you.
Okay.
Detectives learned that 2 years earlier, when Jeremy was 15, he lured a 7-year-old little girl to the basement of his family's home. And I should mention that Jeremy's bedroom is in the basement. The child had been in the house less than an hour when Jeremy abused her.
So this is something that's went through the courts, juvenile court, and been, you know, supported.
Well, let's get into that.
Okay, yeah.
Unbelievably, the case had been informaled, meaning the charges were dropped in exchange for the offender agreeing to complete certain criteria. Jeremy Gipson had been ordered to undergo intensive psychological treatment with regular therapy sessions.
Well, yeah, our treatment, I'm going to start a business like that. My treatment would involve a .357 and one bullet. Come on in here, son, and receive your treatment. Oh, you're the 15-year-old that raped a 7-year-old kid? Yeah, come on in here, bud. We'll take care of you.
Yet Gipson had only attended a few sessions before completely abandoning therapy. Juvenile justice authorities had failed to reprimand Jeremy, and his sentence stated if the therapy wasn't completed, that he would be sent to a juvenile program where he would be essentially in juvie.
For a few years.
In child jail, yes. Yet, he'd managed to slip through the cracks. Due to his age, no one in the neighborhood was aware of his past discretions or that he was a sexual predator. Jeremy had managed to rape a 7-year-old girl without any type of punishment.
And he got away with it. You're not, I'm sorry, I don't want you to live in my house anymore. I don't give a fuck if you're my kid or not. Seriously, like, you need to go on somewhere. You need to go to that damn pedo trailer park down in Florida or some shit and see if they'll let you live in a shed or something, because you are a kid and
what
you don't
is
have
he,
a job.
Bubbles?
Yeah, he's Bubbles. Well, he's not cool as Bubbles. Not going to rape a 7-year-old, okay?
In Pervert Park.
With his kitties.
What you're talking about.
Pervert now, Park, yes.
Very interesting documentary, by the way, if you've never seen it.
You can't find it. It's hard to find.
It's hard to find nowadays. Now, according to neighbors and those who knew the Gipsons, the house was always full of children. The Gipson children hosted overnight sleepovers and friends constantly, and none of the parents were aware that Jeremy was a child sex predator.
Except his parents?
Except his parents.
I mean, what in the world? If you, okay, you had this kid who did this terrible thing, and I'm always so heavy-handed, I know that. And if it was my own kid, you know, who knows? I don't know if I could stomach it, but anyway.
Well, no, because the difference is, if this was your kid or my kid, we would be like, no, your ass is going to fucking therapy.
Oh, you're going
to
do it.
I don't care if you want to go
yeah,
or not.
Right.
Like, we're not parents who are just going to let our child decide, well, I'm not going to do that.
Well,
no, you do the crime, you're doing the time.
Why? If this did happen, my kid was involved, rape of a 7-year-old child, and all this, and no one knows but me, I'm not going to be hosting freaking sleepovers.
Well, I'm not
dude.
Either.
Okay, I'm not gonna.
Well, and I think it will bring up an interesting conversation later.
And the fact
of how much culpability does that of does Carolyn have in the situation?
And the fact there's no follow up within the system, you can't have these alternative programs and stuff. I don't care if it's a drug program for adults in jail and all that. If there's not follow up and making sure that people go through it
and that they're accountable
and held them accountable, and that's just either them being undermanned, underfunded, or just lazy or shitty at their job. But you have to have follow up. If you don't do that, you got to go to and you know do the other. You got to go to jail.
Dinah Thornsberry had no way of knowing that when she allowed her daughters to spend the night in the Gipson house, which they often did, they were not safe. Armed with added information, investigators approached Jeremy Gipson one more time for an interview.
Yeah, I bet they're ready now.
The first time Jeremy was interviewed, Carolyn had been in the room with him. Now Jeremy was asking investigators for privacy. He told them he had to get something off his chest, but he didn't want his mom in the room. Once alone with detectives, Jeremy said he had left the Gipson home late that night and hung out with two older men, though he wouldn't provide their names. During this time, the three consumed alcohol, smoked marijuana, used methamphetamine, he referred to it as crank, and he took something he was told was liquid acid, so he thought he had taken LSD as well.
Jeez Louise.
So meth, LSD, alcohol, and marijuana.
Sounds like a hell of a cocktail right there.
That's called getting loaded.
I don't want anything to do with that buzz. That sounds really weird.
It does. Now, when he returned to the family home, his girlfriend Rachel was asleep in an upstairs bedroom. Jeremy went to the basement bedroom to smoke more marijuana. According to Jeremy, it was just after midnight. Jessica, who allegedly had a crush on him, came down the basement stairs and found him smoking pot. Now, this is not an entirely unlikely scenario, Dylan. You've got this preteen girl crushing hard on her friend's older brother.
Right. And that happens.
It does happen. Now, you were the younger brother, but did you ever have any of your sister's friends who were, you know, interested in the younger brother?
Because
you were a big lad.
I was a large lad.
Yeah.
Yes. With tiny hands and feet and a huge head.
Yes.
I mean, who couldn't? Who wouldn't be crushing on this?
I don't know.
You know what I mean?
I'm just curious if they were interested in you, Dylan.
I'm not a player. I just crush a lot. You know, Big Pun said this a long time ago in Fat Joe. They were trying to tell us.
You know, I had a friend with an older brother, and I never had a big crush on him, but he used to beat the shit out of me all the time. So there's that. He actually was like... he treated me more like you would treat a younger sister, like
yeah.
Bullying, and he'd just like beat me up and shit all the time than he did his own sister.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. You reckon that means he liked you or something?
Maybe. I don't know. Or he's just an asshole. But he like terrorized me as a child. Okay. So she's got a crush on him. He's smoking pot. You know, she's all like, hey. So he offers her a joint and the two smoke together. And then he asks her to help him find his bowl so he can smoke more pot.
Okay.
So a pipe, a bowl, whatever whatever you want to call it.
Marijuana paraphernalia.
Yes. But she refused to help him find this.
So she's caught him smoking pot. Now she's smoking pot with him. They're chilling. But then when he asks to help look for the ball, she says no.
Yeah. And that is when Jeremy hit Jessica in the back of the head. And he continued hitting Jessica. And when she starts screaming, he places his hands around her neck. What happens next is nothing short of monstrous.
I gotta say, I gotta go on the record saying I don't believe the story one bit. This part of it.
While choking Jessica, he pulled down her pants and sexually assaulted her. During this time, he admitted to continuously gripping her neck, then releasing it, like before she would pass out, which is torturous.
Must torture.
He then rolled her over and sodomized the girl while still choking her. And by the time he finished assaulting Jessica, Jeremy realized she was dead.
Oh, oops. That's a piece of shit, dude.
In a panic, Jeremy grabbed an electrical cord, wrapped it around her neck, and pulled tightly. In his drug stupor, he thought it would appear as though Jessica had committed suicide. But after sobering up a bit, Jeremy realized no one was going to believe a happy 12-year-old girl had decided to kill herself in the bedroom of her friend's older brother.
Or sexually assault herself. So how's that going to work, bud?
Well, again, I don't think he's the smartest kid in the room and isn't really thinking that, you know, there's forensic evidence.
I don't believe. I think he lured her down there. He had intent. The entire time. And, I mean, he's already acted on it before. And he knew what he was doing. That's what I think.
After a few hours, Jeremy loaded Jessica into the trunk of his girlfriend's car, then drove her out to Iroquois Park, where he wrapped her up in the landscape netting and dumped her body.
So, his girlfriend's upstairs in this home. Yes. This entire evening.
Yes.
And he's in the basement murdering this child.
Yes.
Okay.
Jeremy returned to the Central Avenue home and went to sleep like nothing had happened.
Another sign of someone who has issues, right? Yeah. If you can do this and be okay with it and go have a nice meal or just chill or sleep and rest, then you're a monster. You have no empathy. You have no guilt.
Jeremy's confession, along with evidence, was given to a grand jury. A judge ruled the case would be handled in an adult court. Jeremy Gipson was given a $1 million cash bond. 62 days after Jessica's body was found, and one day after the grand jury indicted Jeremy Gipson with first-degree murder, he accepted a plea deal. Jeremy was given a sentence of life in prison with the possibility of parole in 25 years. In February of 2020, he was denied parole. He will be eligible again in 2030. 17-year-old Jeremy was remanded to custody at the Cabinet for Human Resources Treatment Center for Youthful Offenders. Now, that's quite a nameful. Until he turned 18 on October 3rd of 1995. Then he was sent to prison. Jeremy is currently 45 years old and serving time at the Kentucky State Penitentiary in Eddyville, Kentucky. The Jeremy Gipson case sparked outrage in Kentucky regarding the way in which juvenile sex offenders are protected. Jessica's murder prompted calls to the highest state officials asking for changes in the secretive juvenile laws. Diana Thornsberry said, quote, "If I'd known, I would have never sent my daughters over there."
Well, who would?
Well, I think most parents would not send their child into the directly into the hands of a predator.
No, I mean, she'd been over there before. This is not the first time she'd ever been over there, right?
Yeah,
this,
I mean, Jessica and her two sisters, Patricia and Stephanie, they had been guests in the Gipson home multiple times.
Like I said, I understand the need.
There's always a house full of kids.
The need for privacy and stuff like that in juvenile cases. But I'm telling you, in my opinion, with certain crimes, certain types and levels of violence, sexual assault, rape, murder, child molesting, all that, that needs to be in another category. And I don't know how you would structure it, but you've got to get that information in some form out to the public. I don't know. It just seems this wouldn't have happened to her by him if people had known, right? I mean, yeah.
Who would send the state had just followed through with monitoring and making sure that he was going to therapy.
Well, see, he
following
had...
up with this very right. dangerous young person.
How are you? Of course, we.
I mean, this is not the kind of juvenile crime where he pickpocketed somebody or stole a couple packs of gum from the pharmacy.
Yeah, or some vandalism, some dumb kid stuff, broke some windows.
This is serious. This is some serious crime.
Very serious.
That he's committed.
Very serious. And he essentially got away with it the first time. There wasn't that much. He might have had a couple of court days. He might have been scared for a second. But then he figured out, hey, the system's cumbersome. It's bureaucratic. And I'm slipping through the cracks. And I don't have to even go to a set in therapy meetings. So I can just do whatever I want. And then nobody even knows what I did. Because, I mean, I can understand from the parent's point of view, that's not really something you want to advertise, because that would just be so horrible to have a child who did something like that. But, yeah.
When the 7-year-old victim's parents learned about what Jeremy had done to Jessica, they were just completely in shock. The child's parents spoke to the media, stating that they blame the system for failing to protect the community and other children from Jeremy Gipson. They also felt some guilt, like, well, we should have, if we were able to do more, then we could have protected her. But at the end of the day, it's not their responsibility.
Well, no, this is the system.
The state, yeah. Exactly. Now, according to the state, Jeremy should have completed the therapy program or been sent to a juvenile facility. But as we know, that didn't happen. So the state failed Jessica Thornsberry as it failed the 7-year-old victim.
I don't think these types of people rehabilitate. So I don't think they do either. I don't think if he had done therapy or went to juvie for a few years or whatever, I don't think it would have changed him. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm wrong, or maybe at least gave him some pause because he paid some kind of a penalty or price. But I can certainly tell you, letting him slip through the cracks and not having any kind of paying any kind of back or any kind of justice served is certainly not going to slow him down. It's not going to stop him from doing it again.
No, and it seems a person like Jeremy is going to seize that as a, ooh, I'm above the law. I can get away with anything that I want.
Well,
he's 17. He's out running around all hours of the night, drinking, taking drugs with adults. I don't even know who they are.
Well, I mean, when you're 17, you're kind of full of piss and vinegar anyway. You know, nobody.
Well, I'm curious about what kind of home life these children had, because it seems like there wasn't a whole lot of supervision. Again, he's a minor. His teenage girlfriend is sleeping overnight in the house, which. Yeah. Most parents are not okay with that. Now, I have known some parents who were, I guess, a little more lenient about these types of things. I've had friends that their teenage daughter had boyfriends spend the night at the house, and that always blew my mind because that was definitely not allowed in my house growing up.
My daughter's boyfriend could stay tonight if they want to sleep in the bed with me, right? And we can see how that works out for them.
Yeah, I mean, up until I was an adult, my mom would make me and my boyfriend sleep in a different room if we were in her house.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, until I came home with a baby and was like, oh, yeah, by the way, this is my baby and this is my baby daddy. She's like, well, I guess.
Y'all can sleep in the same room.
But I'm not happy about it.
Right.
Because you're not married.
And you can return the chastity belt because I had to pay a deposit.
Yeah, pretty much. So I just feel like he's out sneaking around, his girlfriend's staying over. I mean, it just seems like maybe there's not a lot of supervision in this household.
Well, and on top of that, we've got to discuss the fact that she knew what her son has already done. And you're just playing with fire.
She's failing to protect her children.
And other children.
The other children, yes.
That would be the last thing I would allow. If I even allowed my kid to keep living with me, honestly, because I'm not sure how that would work. But I would never, ever allow other girls or kids to come over and stay. And if for some reason I did, I would be over them like a damn overbearing helicopter parent.
Wouldn't most people want their... If your child had committed this kind of crime that is just the most unspeakable, horrific shit that, you know, you can even think of, like, I can't believe my son did this to a 7-year-old kid. Would you not be concerned about your son's mental health, his welfare, getting him help, that you would make him go to therapy? Because wouldn't you be trying everything you could to fix your kid?
Well, again, is there a
button where we can restart him and,
well, yeah,
reset the mode or something? Well, but this mom just seems like whatevs.
Well, it's just like you said. It's about, you know, it doesn't seem to be a real strong parent figures there in supervision. Or you certainly would. It wouldn't matter if he wanted to follow up or not. You would make sure he goes through this. Because the whole point of that is to help him get better.
Right.
And not do these things. And you're just setting him up, your son, who's a piece of shit, child molester, up for failure because you're surrounding him with other victims.
Well, I'm curious about what kind of maybe enabling was going on in this household. If mom was in denial about what he had done. I don't know.
Or didn't believe it. Oh, surely not. Maybe they're lying. Yeah, who knows?
Jeremy's defense pointed to the fact that he was never officially charged with sexual assault, even as a juvenile. The offense report that was dated November 8th of 1992 lists first-degree rape as the crime, yet he was never technically convicted, but instead was given this certain criteria to meet to get the charges dropped. So his lawyers are pointing to the fact that, well, you can't even really call him a sex offender because he was never convicted of a crime, even as a juvenile.
See that shit right there? Even though they know why it wasn't officially written out, because there was some plea or deal involved.
Informal
deal with a juvenile. That's the fucking shit. And I know they're just doing their job, but that's the stuff I would have problem doing that as a lawyer.
Yeah, it would be difficult to be an attorney and handle criminal cases where you know your client is guilty and is a piece of shit and you're signing on to defend them.
Yeah, I don't know how.
And yes, everyone is entitled under our Constitution to a fair trial and a legal defense, and more power to those folks who can do that job.
But what if you get that kid off?
I just couldn't do it.
And he goes out and victimizes or murders another person, another child, young person. How do you live with that? I mean, seriously. Maybe some lawyers out there can give us some feedback about their experience or what they think about, you know, dealing with that. Or is it just a, hey, everybody deserves a fair, proper trial, I'm just here to do my job, you know? And if you see something that can make your client win,
well, I
or
guess
help his
if
case,
you look at the judicial system and the way the legal process works, it is a checks and balances. I mean, if the prosecution, if they don't do a very good job of having a rock solid case and having the good evidence, you know, the defense can tear it down, plant reasonable doubt in a jury's mind. So, I mean, I guess in some way it's a checks and balances that if you're a prosecutor, you need to be on your fucking toes. You need to have all the T's crossed and the I's dotted. And if you're law enforcement, you need to make sure you have all the evidence locked in and you've done a solid investigative job, right?
Yeah, and we certainly don't want to pile up on defense attorneys or anything like that, because we've certainly seen out of control prosecutors with, you know, that think they have a theory and that they, and it gets completely
just
wrong.
Railroad people into jail. Yeah.
And then they're just like, oh, sorry, and let you out. Like, we'll let you out is your prize. You know what I mean? You just took years, even decades off my life. There was a recent case you were telling me about. That there was two young men or...
Yeah, so we can talk about that more in a minute, but the famous forensic pathologist,
yes,
what's his name, Dr. Henry Lee, was recently found in a civil case, I guess guilty of falsifying evidence.
He basically said he tested something and got these results and it hadn't been tested.
And sent like a 17 and 18-year-old guy to prison for murder for over 30 years, and they've now been released and exonerated. The towel that he claimed had their blood didn't even have blood on it. It was like oil or something. Had never been tested, but he was like, oh no, I did, and signed off on it.
That's a big deal right there.
Well, think about it. It opens a door to all these cases that he's worked on over the years.
High profile cases too.
That the convictions could be overturned.
Or to at least get a right to a new trial, and you never know what can happen during trial.
Anyway, it's a pretty crazy story. We can talk more about that later.
So Henry Lee's a damn lie, it turns out.
Possibly, yeah.
Allegedly.
Mm-hmm. Now, Diana Thornsberry sadly passed away in 2021. The question, Dylan, should juvenile sex offenders be required to register? Because this case really brought up a lot of feelings and a lot of conversations in the state about how juvenile sex offenders should be handled. Should the community be made aware of these child sex predators? And again, we mentioned this earlier, but should his mother have been charged as well? Because in my opinion, she's culpable. She was aware of her son's previous rape of a child, yet she continued to endanger other children, including her own children, by allowing them into her home where she knew her son was a potential threat.
And it seems not even like having, you know, good supervision over the environment. I mean, that's certainly what it seems like. I think the first thing you're going to have people bring up when you present that question in that form is the fact that the term sex offender is just this umbrella term that includes the most evil, monstrous things you've ever heard. And it goes all the way down the scale to, hey, it was you have cases nowadays in certain states where a 12-year-old has sent another 12-year-old a picture of their body parts or whatever, and then they're both turned around and charged for possessing child pornography. You see, that's quite different in my mind than some 50-year-old guy possessing that same picture. Or you have someone who dated someone, they were just barely a year and a half, 2 years apart in age, but technically they're charged, you know, for like statutory rape and stuff. You know, I feel like those are different cases compared to full, you know, the monsters.
Well, again, maybe there should be some kind of case by case basis. Maybe there should be a review board that reviews these cases and determines whether this child is a threat to the public, and
there you go.
The community needs to be made aware,
and that can be done behind closed doors. And then the ones that they deem, hey, it's just, you know, two kids, or you know, that wasn't really that doesn't really is not a danger for the public. But these cases are different, and people need to be made aware. That's a great idea. That's a way to still keep it private.
In these cases like this, where we have that he has sexually assaulted a child. And yes, he's a minor as well. But what he did was fucking terrible. Why isn't there mandatory sentencing? Why are we, oh, well, you could just go to therapy. No. He should go to fucking kid prison.
At the very
until
least.
Until he's 21.
At the very least, he should go there until he's 21. At the very least. I agree completely. And I'm sorry, but at 15, that's just not some dumb kid crime or bullshit. It's not vandalism. It's not stealing something, or you know, taking a neighbor's bike or any of this dumb shit, or being pissy to your mom and wanting to fight and all this. It's a monster who just happens to be 15 when they commit this crime. That's all that is. And the 15, I'm sorry, I don't think that means anything. I think they'll do it again and again and again. It doesn't matter their age.
No, I'm glad that this guy's been locked up since he was 18.
And it seems like the parole board's not really buying it. I mean, they don't seem too sympathetic to his case. I mean, honestly, he's already had maybe multiple hearings.
Oh, he has. And yeah, they're not very understanding.
And I don't blame
them. When it comes to Mr. Gipson.
I hope the people in there know what he did.
I'm sure they do, Dylan.
Kicked the shit out of him at the very least.
I'm sure they know what he did.
You know, that always gets out. People make sure it gets out. Be it the staff, the guards, somebody. And plus, everybody wants to see your paperwork as soon as you get in there for those reasons. Find out why you're here. What did you do? Did you harm kids? Did you harm women? Because that's not going to work out for you, usually. Because you have a bunch of men in there missing their wives and kids.
If I ever go to prison, I'm just going to tell everyone I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die.
Okay, Johnny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've decided, you know, prison's not for me, Dylan.
What helped you come to that conclusion?
Well, you know, there's a lot of reasons why prison is not for me. But I think after you've watched those prison shows.
Like the 60 Days In.
Or whatever. Especially like those locked up abroad. I'm not going to prison overseas. Not going to do it.
You're not
putting me in a Nicaraguan jail.
So you're not going to be the sassy trucker. You're not going to go to Dubai, a place where sassy women are not really, you know, looked kindly upon, and raise hell at a rental car place about fees?
No.
Until the, police come?
No.
Okay.
Well, maybe you should elaborate. Tell us the story, because not everyone is invested in TikTok the way that you are invested in TikTok, Dylan.
No, this story broke way outside of TikTok. So, yes, there was a girl. Her TikTok moniker was Sassy Trucker or Truck Driver or whatever. And she is a black woman. And she went to Dubai. I don't know why she's there. But there was some kind of an accident. One of the people she was with was driving the rental car. And they had some kind of an altercation, you know, accident. And they're trying to, you know how Heather did this one time. She hit something in a rental car. And it was kind of messy with them. You got to figure out the insurance and all this. Well, she starts raising hell with them. Or that's what they said. You know how that, allegedly. And I got to, people are going to believe it because she's the sassy truck driver.
Well, her name is Tierra Allen, and she is from Houston. She's a truck driver and an influencer.
Wow.
Who has been arrested for slander.
Yeah. Man, you can't.
And defamation.
When you travel outside of the country that you live in, you have, no matter where you are in the world, you have to know that not everybody, their sense of decency or what's allowed in public or any of that stuff, it's not the same. I mean, you got to walk on eggshells when you're in another. That's the way I look at it. I would never go to another country and do illegal stuff.
No, her passport has been whisked away by the government. She has to stay in the country until she goes to trial. So now she's stuck there?
Yeah.
Yeah. Her credit cards, debit cards, cell phone have all been impounded along with the rental car the day before the blow up, after she was involved in this traffic accident near the Arabian Gulf.
That's what it was. She wanted to retrieve personal items from the car after it had already been in an accident and, you know, in the tow yard. And, dude, you got to know, they never let you do that, no matter where you're at. They don't ever let you have access to the car until everything's figured out or all fees are paid. Oh, my God. And now she done fucked up, dude. Brittany Griner run around Russia with some damn pot, dude. That's a bad idea.
Well, it's like back in the 90s when that dude was over in, was it Singapore?
In the caning incident.
What, did he spit some gum out on the sidewalk or something? And
I think he was graffitiing.
He got caned.
They don't play that shit in Singapore,
dude. No, they don't. You know, I mean, when in Rome, and you have to be respectful of other places' culture and rules. And you don't just get to go up in wherever acting a damn fool. And we have become way too permissive in this country and tolerant of that bullshit.
About shit in public.
Yeah, when we see people acting a damn fool in public, instead of getting out your phone and filming it and like giggling.
We should all shame them.
We should all be like, what the fuck are you doing? Yeah. When we see somebody screaming at a 14-year-old fast food worker or yelling at some elderly person at the grocery store because they didn't bag their milk right or whatever, we should be making an example of those people so that they don't act like a damn fool in public.
I agree.
Should not be tolerant of that bullshit. And so these countries that don't allow it, good for them, because we have just allowed too much here.
Well, it's just what happened to manners.
People be acting a damn fool, be out in the damn street, shitting in the streets. I mean, just crazy fucking shit all the time.
You're in public. My mama, all she had to do is look at us and say, we're in public. Cut that shit out.
I knew better.
Cut it out.
I never in a million years would have dared run around a damn restaurant while my parents were eating dinner, screaming and hollering and carrying on.
You're not going to run and do a knee slide down the
aisle?
Hell
no.
Okay.
Hell no.
My mom would have drop kicked my ass.
No, or they would have left my ass at home.
And you know what? Now that I'm an older adult, watching these mongrel ass kids run around and shit, I appreciate the fact that my mama wouldn't let me run around and act a fool up in places.
Hell, these damn adults be acting a fool. No wonder their kids act stupid.
I think they're NPCs.
Look, okay, I told you the story yesterday. I went into the grocery store to grab a few things. There was a lady who wanted to buy some item that was on sale. It was like a buy one, get one free type of deal. She's an older lady. I mean, she's older than me. She probably had 20 years on me, right? Harassing this young boy that works there. And you know this kid don't give a fuck. He is not interested in what you have to say. He don't even fucking want to be there. He just has to have a job, right? She's bitching at him because she wants to buy this buy one, get one free. It was like Italian frozen ice or something.
Now, you said you had a cart full of these things.
Well, here's
right?
the thing. She was like, these are on sale, but they're, I want to buy more than you have. Do you have extra in the back? And he was like, no, ma'am. Everything that we have is on the floor. Like, it's stocked. We don't keep extras. Like, it's out on the floor.
Right.
So, if you don't have, if there's not enough, I'm sorry. I can't do anything about it. But I want this deal. And he was like, well, have you gotten a rain check? Well, I got a rain check the other day when I came in, and there, I want to buy more than you have. And he was like, okay, well, I can't help you. I don't have, there's not more to give you. The lady had her cart piled full. She probably had 40 boxes of whatever.
She took all of it.
It was every fucking box of whatever this was. Her cart was full of this, and it was like Italian ice or something, right? So she's arguing with him. Well, can't you get it from a different store? And he was like, ma'am, the nearest store in our chain is 30 minutes away. It's in Asheville. But you're welcome to drive to Asheville and see if they have it. But I can't just get them to ship it here for you. That she kept on and on and on and on at this guy until he finally just walked away from her while she's speaking. He just fucking walks off.
Good for
him. Good for him. Then I see this woman and she's got her cart and it is piled probably 40 boxes of this shit. And to have the audacity to complain that she can't buy more.
You greedy ass. You just took it all. This great deal on this yummy Italian ice, apparently. And would you do that?
No!
Would you clear the shelf of an item?
No.
Even if it was a great deal and you loved it?
No!
I would feel like that's rude.
It's a very asshole move, right?
It's just like the people...
I would never do that. I'm just not that kind of person, first of all. Secondly, if I was, I'm not going to harass this... person about getting more.
The reason there
I'm
are
just
none.
Gonna be glad that I caught the deal and I have the few items that I got and I'm making my way out the store. And that's the point, is she didn't even have a few things. She had like 40 boxes of whatever this frozen her ice cream treat was, right?
Look, I would be,
but that's the kind of shit that I'm talking about, is like, what the fuck is wrong with you?
I would be so tempted as the employee, even at my age now, 45, to say, the reason we don't have any is because you got them all in your fucking cart, lady. And you either take those out right now and pay for them and leave, or I'm going to take them back. I'm not going to let you have them. So how you like that judgment call I just made?
I'm going to shove this delicious frozen treat up your ass.
Yeah, this watermelon Italian ice is going up sideways.
Get out my store.
No, but okay.
But I'm just saying, that's an example of something that I recently, because I came home and told you, I was just like, you will not believe.
Oh, yeah.
This fucking 20-minute thing I observed, this conversation.
And you couldn't
whatever.
Even look away. It's like a train wreck.
Yeah.
Because the audacity.
Well, once she's blocking the things I need, and I'm standing there trying to get into the freezer door to grab the thing that I want, and she won't budge.
Yeah.
And because I'm like a patient, you know, trying to be polite person, I'm just sort of standing there until I'm finally like, excuse me. And even then she doesn't want to budge. And she's still bitching at this kid. But yeah, it was like hard to avoid.
Yeah, people like that are ridiculous. And that's the type of person you can never make happy. I mean, seriously. So anyway, here we are. But one last thing here.
Yes, here we are, Dylan. And here's the one last thing here.
His mother?
Yes.
What type of charges do you think she should have, if, you know, who cares what the law says? What do you think? I think at the very least negligence. Negligence or some type of weirdly worded aiding and abetting a child in some type, I don't know. I mean.
Yeah, I think negligence I mean, I know it would be very hard to charge her and have it stick.
Well, yeah.
But at the same time, I just think she's partially to blame for this, bro.
How could she not be? I mean, you should at least, even if you're a selfish-ass person who doesn't think about other people, you should not want these young people who may end up being a victim of your son who's already done a terrible thing, you wouldn't want them around them for his sake, right? I mean, let alone for the victim's sake. It's just very odd to me. So it really doesn't matter. I think you nailed it on the head there. There's not a strong parents in that household. I don't think there could be, or he would have not been allowed to slip through the cracks like that and they would keep setting him up like this, or, you know, allowing other children around him because he may do something terrible.
Well, I'm letting him sneak in and out of the damn house. And I mean, it just seems like this kid has no fucking rules. No wonder he's a little delinquent. He has no supervision and no rules.
Well, I'm glad he's still in jail.
Yeah. Fuck him. Fuck you, Jeremy Gipson, with a P. Gipson.
It's Gipson? G-I-P-S-O-N?
Yeah.
No.
Gipson.
I thought it was Gibson all this time.
Well, I've been trying to say Gipson, but it's an odd spelling.
Yeah, Jeremy, won't you eat a dick? Like, for real.
Yeah, eat a dick, Jeremy.
Like, one that you don't want to eat. Like, even if you like eating dicks, this would be one you don't care for.
Go eat a snake dick.
Huh.
Yeah.
Little slithery dick.
It's gross. It's the grossest thing I can think of. Snake dick.
You gonna stick your face in that snake hole over there?
Go stick your dick in a snake hole, you piece of shit.
All right, Heather. So, look, next week's can't be about... We're gonna have to get somebody else in here. It can't be a child victim.
We're not gonna have
it. I can't do it.
No, we're not gonna. We have a different story for next week. Different case.
Okay. Well, I'd like to thank Amber for her support over there at Patreon.
Yes, thank you so much, Amber.
And possibly Scott, if we missed you last week.
We appreciate everyone who supports the show. And if you would like to join us at patreon.com/mountainmurderspodcast, you can also support the show, get some of that ad-free content.
And a lot of extra content.
Bonus episodes, be part of the Discord, all of the things, Dylan.
Join us.
Yeah, we promise we will have a midweek for you. We promise.
Look, I know y'all have heard this before, but this was not our fault this time. I promise you. We got zapped, so our equipment got screwed up, you know, and we could have went old school like back in the day and, you know, sat in a McDonald's parking lot and ate fries at midnight and uploaded very slowly over some crappy Wi-Fi.
And we have done that before in the past.
We have done that in the past very early on, but you know what? That's a lot. That's a lot to do. But anyway, we're back, and we're just going to keep it rocking. So here's our late this week's and the midweek's coming up tomorrow.
This is the late one?
That's the late one.
This one right here. This is the one, Dylan.
And the one tomorrow is going to be on time.
Oh, my gosh.
I hope
so, too.
All right. Can't wait to see you in the midweek, Heather.
I can just nail you down without technical difficulties. We should be good.
That's fine.
Okay. Well, we hope you guys have a great week. We will bring you the midweek tomorrow, Wednesday.
Oh my God, it's going to be so on time.
And I promise the case we will have for you coming up this next weekend will not involve children.
That's going to involve canaries. The famous canary murder of 1973.
What, did it go in a mine shaft or something?
Yes. How'd you know?
I don't know.
Yeah, they found the gas company culpable.
Okay.
Yeah, that's not even a good joke. Let's go. Let's go ahead and get out of here.
I'm like, what? Okay. Yeah, it's late. Wrap it up. Bye.
All right. Bye.